you back to that meeting you referenced on the 28th of January. Okay. You said that there was a mention of the media report with 6 and 6 that day. Can you just tell us about the discussion that ensued at the board meeting that night? How long it was there any objection, any opinion given on it?
I think that you find in this world there's lots of opinions on lots of different things. But the main focus on that evening was really the proposal that I made to government after all of the discussions, both with the Department of Sport Ireland, Bank of Ireland, UEFA, and brought them through what the outline of the outcome was going to be. But that was in parallel from having sight on the MOU as released to the terms and conditions, or certainly the terms that the Department and Sport Ireland were going to place on us. What the board discussion was, okay, was there's going to be further reforms required, there's going to be further conditions imposed. And I suppose the challenge around the 6 and 6 is that for whatever reason that was in the media that day, that was a possible change. So there was a discussion. The view of the board was okay, well, whatever it is, we need the money to measure to go. All I'm saying is that there was it was in the minutes that there was a discussion on 6v6 because it was in the media.
That a discussion ensued from the fact that it was in the media. Not just as a reference that it was in the media.
It was in the media, yeah.
Yeah, okay, that's before you meet.
But that's the reference.
Yeah, okay. Yeah. Following that, someone raised that. Did you raise that, or was another person? And when that happened, how...
If the question is, I suppose, did I suggest 6 and 6 to the government?
No.
But
you didn't have sight of the
measure.
Okay, so someone brought this up that had been in the media that day, and the discussion ensued. Is that correct?
Yeah. It was in the minutes. It had to be a discussion.
That was discussed and debated.
It was discussed as the comment in the minutes was that there's media reports about 6 and 6.
Yeah.
So what I can say is that we discussed the proposal. We discussed that there was going to be further reforms. Clearly, didn't have full sight of what those reforms were, and that the reference to 6 and 6 was because it was in the newspaper. So we obviously discussed it. However, what was clear and what mandate was given was that what was most important was get the funding for the organisation,
regardless of the reform measures.
Well, that's. Well, it's not regardless, that's the mandate that I was given. So then we signed an MOU, and I was happy to sign the MOU with the terms and conditions, and whatever contentious terms and conditions there may have been there, certainly could talk about what I'm comfortable from the fact that ultimately it's the members who are going to decide as to whether they're acceptable or not. So it's not my decision to make.
Okay, but
those are the terms in which people will need to use the funding.
Okay, so you said in your statement the other day, and you repeated it earlier, you were mandated by the board to complete the deal of MOU. That's reflected in the minutes, that word mandate?
I think it was put in starker in different terms, but I've no ambiguity in my mind that I was told by the board to go off and sort out the funding.
Okay, and would there be a special resolution raised about to give you the authority to do that?
No, it's a board discussion.
The discussion?
There's a board meeting where we had a discussion, where the outcome of the discussion was that what the board priority was to go and get funding. I can't say it any clearer, so you can call it a mandate, or you can call it an instruction, or you can call it a request. It was what it was. But you have to remember the environment in which people were having that discussion and the uncertainty that was hanging over the FAI, where it was absolutely critical that the funding was secured. most important thing.
Did any board members request of you to see the MOU on the 29th, the day that you received it?
No, not that I can remember. So whenever I got it, whenever I saw it, sent it over to the board the following morning. So if somebody asked me at that night for the MOU.
Leading up to that, at any time did anyone request?
No, we haven't discussed as to what the possible terms and conditions could be.
Yeah.
But you have to remember as well, there was an awful lot of media coverage around this. You had all sorts of people walking in and out of government with all sorts of views as to what should happen. You know, from people within football, within Ligue 1, in grassroots, within employees and so on and so forth. So everybody had a view as to what changes should be made, given the difficulties that football faced.
Okay, so you sent this at 9:02. There was some replies, as we know. I think in the statement from the AGR today, they said these weren't replies. Is there any reason why you didn't?
The reason that I didn't, I remember having one conversation with one board member. Maybe I was busy, but I saw what they say, and but there was, in the context of the time and the amount that was going on, it probably wasn't a surprise that I didn't reply to somebody who raised a concern that, this is going to be difficult. The priority was absolutely clear.
But they're fellow board members.
I wasn't trying to be discourteous to anybody. All I wanted to do was carry out the instructions of the board and what they wanted to achieve, which was a funding package. So, and we're getting lost on an MOU. An MOU doesn't have legal standing, but an MOU is on the basis that you do these things, then government is all challenged and others will be able to provide funding to us. I think what people forget around this is that I don't have the power to give effect to some of those terms and conditions. It was always going to come back to the members to decide whether they would accept the conditions that they had to accept. And that's what we're going to go through over the next 3 weeks.
And just finally, just on the MOU, sorry, the data MOU, like the highest elected officer in the FAI, Jonathan Barrison, wasn't in Leeson Lane that day. Why? Can you tell us?
Yeah.
Why
did that avoid it? Sure. Because the minister was very specific in the requirements that he had around the signing of the MOU as it relates to the people in the FAI that he wanted to attend. He also wanted UEFA to attend, and he also wanted people from Ecuador to attend.
Do you regret not standing up to him a bit more, Roy, and saying we have to have someone from the football family there?
Gerry, how do you feel on that day then? Because there was a statement went out on your behalf on the 30th of January saying you welcomed the historic agreement, but then obviously you co-signed this statement the other day. So how were you feeling on the 30th of January?
How was I feeling on the... Well, I knew from the 29th of January that I wasn't on the invite list for the signing of the MOU.
How did you know that? you didn't see the MOU until the 30th.
I wasn't on the invite list for when the signing of the MOU would take place.
Right.
Yeah. So the bottom line is, the way I looked at it is, the FAI was in a critical situation. I wasn't going to be putting anything in jeopardy by trying to gate crash Leeson Lane. Minister Ross didn't want me as the president, the newly elected president, to attend. That was fine. In the sense, there was a bigger picture, as far as I'm concerned. The bigger picture was this, the saving of Irish football. Minister Ross, I've heard since, has made reference to that said statement that I made. And I'd make the same statement again, because despite the fact that I wasn't an invitee, why wouldn't I congratulate the people on all sides who had done their best for Irish football?
How do you feel about the 6v6 personally then yourself?
No, just to finish on that, I'd make the same statement. It was good manners to do. It was the president's role to thank people for their efforts for a long time. People had worked since the previous March, April, and May to keep the association alive. It might have been Roy that went across the road for the signing, but there was a board members that worked from the previous July, day and night, along with the new independents that came in January. I was only in the door 3 days. Like, so in respect to those people, why wouldn't I make a statement?
Mm.
No. It's the way I was brought. It's good manners.
Yeah. But would you regret Wednesday's statement, the age, like the director's statement?
No, I already dealt with that with Gavin, yeah.
Mm. How do you feel about the 6v6 then, personally, as a concept?
6v6, being brutally honest with it, and I made no secret, I wasn't comfortable with it. But as Roy said, we all have our personal opinions, you know, which we have steadfastly trashed out. And people think the board only meets once a month. It nearly, we all know how many times we meet. But the bottom line is, this is not about Gerry McAnaney. This is not about the president. This is about the future of Irish football. Gerry McAnaney, he could be gone in 3 weeks, 3 months, whenever. Could be good. It's about bringing the game on. We must move on from today. We have to. Football in this country is in a crisis. We're going in the right direction. We have good people on our board. The council members that were here today, they were very, very, as I said, refreshed from what they heard and what they saw. So we hope to build on that. We're coming from a very, very low base, and we hope to build on that, and we hope that people will look at us and say, yeah, they're maybe not so bad, all those guys and gals in there. And they might look and they say, that's why Down, as John O'Regan from the Kerry District League said today, who built the Kerry League over 30 years, from six clubs to 70-odd or whatever it is now, 127. They're the sort of people that we're doing it for, So that's what it's about. It's not personal. So ask me how I felt. It wasn't about me. It's about the football community.
But does the potential tweak to the 10-year rule, is that something that you welcome?
Tweaks? I spent...
Interpretation.
I have no idea what will happen with interpretation. I'm not on the board of Sport Ireland, I'm not in the Department of Sport. Of course, if people want to make welcome changes, I'm sure the football community would welcome them. There are many people, there's 28 or 30 people that may be, of course, but if it happens, it happens. If it doesn't, it doesn't. We'll still be talking anyway, Dan, you and me.
Of course.
5 minutes for today's lessons.
Right, this issue of the interpretation of the 10-year rule, like, are you worried that could be perceived as a concession just to try and win over possibly people on the board who would be affected by it, that would have to go?
Sorry, get a concession by whom?
Well, from the
same thing, not at all. To be honest with you, at the end of the day, what you're trying to do is get to, you've got to go back to the funding package, which is appropriate for the organisation and its futures, under a set of terms and conditions which are fair and acceptable to all. So I don't see that as I'm trying to argue against the interests of the members or any part of the membership. Ultimately, what you want is to bring people as much along the journey together as you can. So whatever we can do to achieve that, that's what we do. There are things that we may not be able to achieve.
I guess what I'm saying is it a source of discomfort to the board to discuss it when some of those people on the board would have to leave if the memorandum is?
That actually hasn't arisen, in terms of certainly people on the board, worried about doing things because of it might affect their own particular circumstance. So those things.
Roy, we're here today at the behest of the council, who had fears and concerns about MOU and other matters. Should it have been the other way around? Should it have been yourselves and the board going to the council and saying, look guys, this is what we're doing here?
Yeah, and I suppose that's why there's an EGM called for the end of the month. And equally we were supposed to have an AGM and whatever it was in Galway, but because of July, but in Galway in July, which we had to cancel. So equally we've just got to place with all the stakeholders, including the UEFA and FIFA, and clear their position and what they're supporting and what they're willing to support. And we only got to that position in the last week, the last 5 years. So the good thing about the emergency council is that it has been a good opportunity to listen to people's concerns and fears. Not all which are around the MOU or concerns, but the other concerns about other things. And I think today was actually refreshing. We've been trying to do as a board is get to the stage of terraform in terms of a set of proposals that we can bring to the members and be able to communicate those proposals clearly such that they're able to make an informed decision. So, yeah.
Roger, you were brought here rather than you bringing the council here, it's just the opposite of it.
Yeah.
Do you feel your position is strengthened now as chair of the FAI? I mean, did it cross your mind the last few days or even today, coming in today, that you might be asked to resign or that you might even put yourself forward for resignation? Or do you feel more sort of entrenched and determined now after the meeting and judging by the response of people going out that you did speak well today and you alleviated a number of fears? Do you feel now that your position is strengthened perhaps as chairman and that you're here for the long haul? There's a few in that.
Yeah. Have I ever thought of resigning? No. Firstly, I took this role on for a particular purpose, and we've got to see that through. There's a good bit to go along with that. As to how it got on, I'll be here. I mean, I think I said at the outset to anybody in council, we want to watch this again. I'll stay as long as I think I'm adding value, and as long as people want me to be there. So if people want to call for my resignation, and that's what people wanted to happen, well then fine. Well, I'm committed to this, and I'm committed to staying with this. Because there's enough time to be achieved, but we're only on step one here. Step one is actually just getting to a point of financial stability. That's only a starting point. There's so much more that we need to do.
What will be the next few steps in our own
mind? The next few steps in my own mind was one is the reputation and public profile of the organisation is really poor, and that needs to be improved. Two, we've undertaken a restructuring of the organisation from a staff perspective. We need to see that better down and work at the high level of confidence that would be the case to some really good people in the FAI. we're a sport which is hugely underachieving relative to be a game or rugby on any sort of metric, and we should be doing an awful lot better. And success for us all will be in the game of football has a place which is much better than it currently has, and that would be good in so many ways, not only for the participants but also for the future funding of the organisation.
Sort of going back to the outset, and obviously it's the theme of the week that the government are the ones who are sort of putting the ultimatum here in terms of the MOU, or one of the stakeholders, as you say. Okay, we spoke to Mick Wallace outside, and he is of an opinion, it's only his opinion, that if it came to it, that they would not push through it, that they'd be too fearful of losing votes and seats in politics.
Yeah.
Which you have yet. Would you disagree with that? Or is it worth the risk?
Well, I do disagree with number one, but number two, in my position, Gerry's position, or anybody who's on the board, to adopt an attitude that you know we're either too big to fail, or no matter what our stakeholders are saying to us, we just ignore that and do something else would be absolutely reckless. So, I know everybody's entitled to their own opinion on these things, but as a member of when you've been told that the funding is available on particular conditions and you don't fulfil those conditions, you just have to reasonably assume the funding won't be there, in which case that's not a good outcome.
And yet, Roy, you're not averse, as you said, the 6v6, the casting vote, is not a condition or a codicil of the MOU. So if, for example, in an AGM, and there was a motion to change it, where the casting vote went from the chairman to the president, that wouldn't be an issue for you.
It's never been an issue for me, you know, and that's a decision that isn't at my making, that's a decision of council.
Yeah. And just finally, there was a legal missive today, a couple of legal missives flying around from Nixon and Martin, the threats of AGMs, and they're not held by August 31st.
Thankfully, as a board, we decided today that we need to reflect on those missives. We only got them last night, so that's what we're doing.
Are you both confident from the tone of the meeting today that this will pass? I'll ask if both of you maybe.
The way I'd look at it is, I know the people in football that were here today, in both rooms, for many, many years. I know, because I'm embedded into them. They go back, they reflect, and the one thing that football people always do, they can say what they like, they do the right thing by football. It might hurt them locally, nationally, or regionally, but they will do the right thing, because that's what they do. So I would hope, in this case, they'll continue in that vein. I have every confidence in the football community in Ireland. I always have. I wouldn't be sitting here if I didn't. I wouldn't have put myself up for election if I didn't have confidence in the people in Irish football. They're good people, you know? Very good people. Sure, I'm looking around at people. I can talk to John Duggan about sports, you know? I can talk to you about Dundalk. I can talk to Finn Hatch about Mark Tye. We can talk to John Fallon about
Spurs.
And we won't talk to John Brennan at all. And Devin is too young.
Not for town.
Not for town, not bad.
Finn Harps meeting today.
Finn Harps. So, listen, we're all football. We, you know, and you know it as well as I do. The good people in football, they do end up making the right decision. Look around the League of Ireland. Look at all the people we know that have put their heart and soul into clubs, into League of Ireland clubs. And their businesses, you know, over the years. Like, people say, they shouldn't do that. They do it because they love it, you know. They might have made the greatest decision of the time, but that's who we are. We're believers.
Mm-hmm. Roy, sorry.
Yeah, I was genuinely encouraged by the questions that were raised in which they were ultimately, I think, you know, the vast majority of people only want to do, you know, the right thing and make the right decisions. And, you know, it's clear that there's parts of this decision which are difficult, but in the round, when I have confidence that people will make a decision and do what's the best interest of Irish football, yeah, I am.
This is the very last.
There was more clarification. Does Philip ask about, would you have any issue with the casting vote being changed? And you said no. The question is, would any of the stakeholders, such as the government or the bank, have any issue with that?
It's not part of the PLA report.
So they won't? They won't.
They've no business. In those terms, they've no business having.